To discuss the inverse relationship between GPA scores and innovation and impact on future education, I'm honored to invite Professor Yong Zhao in conversation with Lieutenant General Arjun Ray, CEO and MD Indus Trust. Professor Zhao is a Foundation Distinguished Professor in the School of Education of the University of Kansas and a professor in educational leadership at the Melbourne Graduate School of Education in Australia. Professor Zhao was University Distinguished Professor at the College of Education, Michigan State University, where he also served as the founding director of the Center of Teaching and Technology. Professor Zhao has been recognized as one of the most influential education scholars. His work focuses on the implications of globalization and technology on education. He's authored over 30 books and over 100 scholarly articles on reforming and reframing education outcomes, personalization of learning, and education technology mistakes. He's an elected member of the National Academy of Education and a fellow of the International Academy of Education. I welcome you, Professor Zhao.
Thank you. Thank you, Tanya.
Professor Zhao, I want to make your acquaintance with Lieutenant General Arjun Ray, Param Vishisht Seva Medal, Vishisht Seva Medal. He is the CEO and MD of Indus Trust and provides vision and strategic direction to all Indus International schools and institutions. Under his leadership, Indus has grown from strength to strength with establishing India's first equal opportunity community school, Startup U for Life Entrepreneurship, and India Robot Lab to develop AI technology to coexist with human teachers through indigenously developed collaborative learning model. General Ray is of the firm belief that the purpose of education is to prepare students to be startup ready, which is to make them future ready, where they're outliers, exponential leaders, innovative individuals, and lifelong learners who strive and thrive in VUCA Plus environment. I welcome you, sir.
A very good evening from India and a very good morning to you, sir.
Thank you, General.
I have always been impressed by your articles and the various books that you have written. And one aspect which resonates a lot with all of us, all of us here at Indus, is this exercise which you have done about the inverse relationship between GPA scores and innovation. There is no doubt in anybody's mind that in the innovation economy, if a future citizen graduates from school, is not innovative, cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn, upskill, reskill, rediscover herself, reinvent herself. According to Yuval Harari, she or he will be consigned to the dustbin of history, what he calls the useless class. So innovation, of course, is the most critical aspect to succeed in a world which is driven by economy, in politics, in real life, in international relations, and in dealing with climate change. Now, I would like to also bring in Mrs. Sarojini Rao, who is the principal of Indus International School, Bangalore, ranked number one in the country for 10 consecutive years. And she has been leading a lot of innovative projects in the school out here. And it may be a good idea to also listen to a practitioner what her views on this topic are about. As I said, what you have said has been well researched and documented by Google as well, by Matthew Mayhew at the New York University, involving 10,000 students in the US, Canada, Germany, and Qatar, and even in China. In China, high school graduates who achieve the highest scores on the, I hope I pronounce it correctly, Gaokao, you'll correct me if I go wrong there, the entrance examination for higher education, achieved less in subsequent life than did those who scored lower. On my own scratch pad, I did a brown paper envelope calculation, which I will show to you on this view foil, to reinforce what you have been writing and saying about. Can I have the slide, please?
Well, thank you. Go ahead.
Right. Now, if you look at the chart here, I put US and India in red colors for the audience to understand. I mean, the data speaks for itself. And look at China, which has just got 8 Nobel Prizes, Japan 20, Korea 1, India 12. Companies in the top 100 innovative list, patents, and the Global Innovation Index. This chart, can I have the slide off, please? Reinforces the point in your book where you have shown innovative countries like Australia, like Finland, like the US, Germany, etc., and countries who focus on getting 100 out of 100 in maths and science, Singapore, China, Thailand, Japan, India, are nowhere on the innovation game. Therefore, the bottom line is this, that the higher the grade point average, the lower is the student's interest in innovation. And what is emphatic is that an academic environment which is based on standardized testing, rote memorization, which discourages creativity and the entrepreneurial spirit, and that's what K-12 education in India and several countries is all about. Students with great grades are often over-focused, and therefore, voluntarily, they shut off all their passions and experiences that ignite innovation. I quote Laszlo Bock from Google. I'm sure you have met him. He says, one of the things from all our data crunching is that GPAs are worthless as a criteria for hiring at Google. Google famously used to ask everyone for a transcript and GPAs and test scores, but we don't anymore. We found, he continues to say, that they don't predict anything. And according to him, examination scores are no indication of innate intelligence or innovative capability. Therefore, our question to you, sir, in India, as in all Asian countries, including China, we are obsessed with grades. We had Alex Beard from UK talking a little while back, and he showed us a picture of this famous examination in South Korea, where the whole country comes to a halt. Even the airplane services are stopped for 45 minutes. The police is there on the road to see the kids are not distracted. And the maximum number of suicides are in Korea. Now, in India also, it is a do and die situation for schools. Parents and students included. We have a lot of parents who are putting their kid in primary section, grade one, early year center, and they want to know whether the school education will enable their child to join the IITs and the IIMs and the prestigious higher education institutions in the country. By then, by the time the child reaches grade 12, 40 to 45% of the jobs of the world would have changed. Therefore, according to data from our home ministry, 2,500 students commit suicide every year because of fear of failure or failure in examinations. How do we balance these two extremes? On one side, the parent, the teacher. A teacher evaluates herself that so many kids from my class have done well in maths. She does not say how many kids of her class have got the Booker Award or the Nobel Prize. So how do we balance these two extremes, academics on one hand and innovation on the other hand? And what do you, sir, recommend is an appropriate education intervention which sort of, you know, meets both requirements? That's question number one. And with that, I hand over the mic to you, sir.
Thank you. That's a very powerful statement. First of all, I think, you know, the curriculum, every system has a curriculum in whatever you do. And private schools, you know, you got all this IB, you got all this. The curriculum is questionable. You know, in India, I'm sure you have schools, you have to teach math, reading, science, but we have to question what we want our children to learn. Is that truly going to help them to be future ready? As you talk about future, which by the way, I don't believe we can get kids future ready because they are the creators of the future. There is no future without them. So we need to ask the question, are we preparing our children to be able to create the future? That I doubt any system works. You look at a GPA, any of them, you basically, we now have a manufactured scarcity. We manufacturers, you know, you only have so many Harvard, Yale, Oxford University. But today, educational opportunities have completely opened up if children want to do it. So I think every education system has to ask themselves, do you want to force all your children to take these courses? And that maybe you only need to take one third of the course as commonly required, and the rest should be studied by students. You know, I'm not a big fan of designing personalization for children. We need to grow these children as young as possible to be the organizers, to be the owners of their own learning. Second thing I think we need to ask ourselves, grades. You know, we put students, 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds together as 1 year. But if you want really personalized learning, that's wrong. Because, you know, imagine you get a 5-year-old, but are you at the beginning of the 5-year-old or at the end of the 5-year-old? That's a huge difference. Yeah. Why do you push them together to do that? You don't need to group students based on that. I just wrote a book about the whole thing. It's called Learners Without Borders, you know, Learners Without Borders, because we create these borders to control them. Then teachers, I know we have a lot of teachers. Teachers need to be a lot lazier. I think teachers work too hard. Teachers try to teach every student and say, oh, I got 35 students, I got 45 students. I have to teach you to do the same thing. You don't need to. You know, given all the accessibility of YouTube videos, of friends, of AI, of everything, you don't need to teach all of those things. The most important thing, I think, of the data you put out is that schools have been trying to homogenize people into a force, try to fight for the manufactured scarcity. I say manufactured. Mm-hmm. We say, you know, we pretend there are a limited number of spots for you in life. But actually today's life is as much as we can create. We need to get our children to be creators of the future, to take advantage of what's possible, peer tutoring, learning globally, and all of those things. COVID-19 has given us that opportunity to create learning for a different type of education. So by the way, I really want to say, I would invite all of us to imagine education without thinking about schooling. Because right now, whenever we talk about reimagining education, we imagine our schooling. You know, we think about, we have to have a curriculum, we have to have classrooms, we have to have buildings. We don't need that. You know, education can operate without schools. Of course, schools cannot operate without education. Can we imagine education without schooling?
Mm. Would you like to say something?
Good morning, Professor, and good evening from here. It's a pleasure and honor to have you with us this evening. You did speak about reimagining education, and that is the whole aspect of our discussion. And the fact that you have brought out very clearly in your book, Never Send a Human to Do a Machine's Job, what struck me most about technology, which has failed to disrupt and transform education, is the what, the objective. The objective still remains the same. The objective of education with introduction of technology and the objective of education with traditional teaching is still the same. And therefore, transformation is not going to happen. So schools, like you rightly said, schools have to prepare students for, or learners for a future that has already arrived, that is so uncertain and chaotic. So how, I mean, you have written a lot about it, but to put it in a nutshell, we would like to understand how do schools which are so steeped in standardized testing, especially Asian schools, schools in Asian countries, how do they go about this kind of, getting these entrepreneurial competencies in students, building those competencies in them, training their teachers, because the teacher is still relevant, the teacher is extremely relevant. So how do they go about this whole challenging task? Because you cannot just do away, it's not a surgical treatment. So how do we go about it in a more, in a more modified form?
That's a wonderful question. Thank you so much. I've been working with schools really literally on every continent in different countries. One of the things I've always suggested is that never design something that will happen tomorrow. And never design something that will happen to all teachers. So those are the really two basic things. I think schools are too eager to say, oh, let's have innovation. We can implement next Monday. The education never changes that way. If you invite teachers, parents, or whoever you want to invite, let's say, can we design a school, or I don't like school, can we design an education institution next 5 years? That will happen in 5 years later, not happening tomorrow. You reduce the pressure and people do not resist as much, because when you are designing, think about designing something 5 years later, you are actually changing people's mind. You're changing people's behavior. So think about design something. Again, design not to say, you want to design something to replace what you have, not just to modify. Mm-hmm. I mean, right now, education or educational institutions and schools are too entrenched. There are so many people have interest in this, right? You know, everybody has a stake in this. Teachers, mm-hmm. government, you know, that's political true. Leaders, everybody wants something out of it. You say, no, we're designing something that's so different 5 years later or 10 years later. But you use that process to say, okay, what can we do? And what when we say, what can we do? If you want to start with schools, you want to start with, so say, okay, what can we get rid of? What elements of the school, if we can get rid of? That's the best design approach, right? To say, what can get rid of teachers, get rid of classrooms, get rid of this. Another thing is that I've always argued to say, never try to convince everybody. Never try to design something that will apply to all children and all teachers. So I've been promoting the idea called a school within a school or learning communities within a school. So you want to work and serve the people who are willing to go with you. You don't want to impose this on everybody, because whenever you're imposing on everybody, you are inviting resistance. And when you have resistance, when anything new you're designing, little resistance can undo whatever you're trying to do. Mm-hmm. So in every school, in every situation, you have at least 20 to 25% of people who are not happy. You know, who, if they were not happy with the school, they're looking for something different. Design that for them, with that staff, with students. So that's the kind of model I would encourage. It is very dangerous to try to convince everybody to go with you. You can continue to send them a message. You can continue to invite them to visit, but I would not just try to force everybody to say, let's do it. So innovation should be an invitation, not an imposition.
Thank you. I mean, that clarifies a lot of things, because many times what happens is, when we talk about collaboration, it is wrongly assumed that everyone is part of the vision. But you're right that vision is a lone journey, and there are very few people who become part of that eventually. Thank you, Professor.
Over Thank to you. You.
Connected with this issue, which Mrs. Rao and you have been discussing, is that research studies, and even by your own admission, technology has not transformed education at all. There are huge, big gaps which are still existing, and you have written very articulately on this. We feel there's nothing wrong with technology. There is everything wrong with the existing school leadership and not reimagining reforms. Now, the biggest impediment, and we discussed this yesterday also with a lot of thought leaders of the world, the biggest impediment is the teacher's mentality. And this is the world over. I'm not talking about India or China. I'm talking about US, UK, wherever we are, with odd exceptions. The teacher's mentality, which is anti-creativity. As you know, Ken Robinson has written very extensively, written a book also that school skill creativity. Status quo-minded, a fixed mindset. Now, how do we overcome this particular challenge? And how do we change this thinking from a fixed mindset to a growth mindset, from a status quo mindset to an innovative mindset? Whether it takes 1 year or 5 years, as you said over there, I totally agree with you. But the world needs to understand, the education field needs to understand that the prime importance which content had in the industrial age, that pristine position has been taken over by competencies, creativity, entrepreneurial competencies to succeed in whatever you take up in your life today, whatever future you want to create, whatever future you want to design for yourself over there. So the shift from content to competencies cannot happen, according to my experience, unless the teacher is innovative. And only an innovative person, a leader, can get the troops to become innovative. A leader who is not innovative at all will be an impediment in the growth of creativity in those she or he is responsible for. So we would like your insight into this particular sort of conundrum that we find
out. So, General, I think, you know, there are three points I want to make. Number one, teachers are very diverse. You know, we have young teachers, we have old teachers, we have mid-age teachers. And teachers, some teachers are not happy, they want to change. Some teachers want to stay. So I think, you know, again, with teachers, we need to be very careful not to over-characterize them. So what I would encourage Indus or any other organizations is to create opportunities for the ones who are willing to change to change. I don't think any system can force changes in education. So I've given up on that. No one can change schools. Basically, this is. So what do you want? You want new spots of changes which can lead to bigger changes. So, you know, if you look at globally speaking, there are a lot of new possibilities popping up, but they're all done by individuals, not by government. You know, you cannot force people. So invite. The second point is that we cannot only rely on teachers. We need to create new opportunities to make students teachers. Students, yeah. Peer tutoring. I mean, I saw that you're doing, you guys are doing the right things. You know, is that, you know, imagine students organized globally. We can deal with a lot of, you know, all the geopolitical problems. If they're learning partners, they're not going to go to war with each other. That's another point I want to say. Education has failed since World War II. You know, we are still fighting with each other. China and India are fighting, US and, I mean, it's stupid, right? People are still trying to follow a few dictators. This is wrong. Education should be more than that. Today, we can do that. Our students can be their own educators and can be educators for each other. So organizations like yours, I would love to see you have students run learning communities, or you can call it schools. You know, invite young children, old children, they can do it. I've studied actually schools organized by students. Think about it, tutoria in Mexico, think about the, you know, independent school in Massachusetts, they can do it. So let's forget about the idea teachers are the only source of learning. That's not true. You know, since YouTube, I'm sure the cuisine of food quality in India has improved. Everybody goes to, you know, to YouTube. You don't need the other teachers to think like that. The third point is with school leaders. We need, again, invite, identify school leaders who wants to change. I think our education system wasted a lot of money and resources trying to convince leaders, teachers to change. You know, actually, General, you may have the data. In India, how much money we spent on called professional development, PD? How much impact they have? Nothing. Almost like that. Why do you do that? You know, let's stop doing that. We create something new. Also, if you look in business, looks like you are very familiar with business. Look at Google, all of this. Google existed because it did not learn from other organizations. Google existed because it's powerful. Amazon exists because of Sears was stupid, you know. So you do not try to be others. You create new possibilities. I think education, biggest problem is we try to change the existing system. We try to force students, parents to change at the same time. And actually when there's no big vision to change, there's no one vision. So we want to have some different visions for different people. Education should be like a free market. You know, it should be funded by government, but everybody may have different experiences. You know, for example, I've been trying to promote a model. I said, can we run education like a learning festival? You have so many different opportunities. Children, parents, teachers can be exposed to. We all become co-learners. You know, I think a lot of times in our education system, we treat this education as a military kind of exercise, or as a prison in our schools. There's only one way to learn. We assess you, we test you, but ultimately, I want to look at our children, your three-year-olds, your five-year-olds. What can we do to create the opportunity for them? The opportunities exist now with technology, but why do we constrain them? Actually, you were talking about China. I go back to China a lot. I mean, if you go to rural areas, even some urban areas, when children can learn much better online, but their teachers are controlling them. You cannot learn, you know, because I have to control you. You have to learn this subject, you have to learn this, but can we liberate them?
I think that's a very sage advice, which brings us to an associated issue. This is about education research. I am not aware of any education research being done as a discipline in any school in the world. There may be odd schools here and there. Even colleges, it is not very common. It's only at the university level where research actually happens. Now, considering the model of the school of the future, which we have recommended, and the principles which we have shared with you over there, what sort of educational research should be done at a school level? Because in this highly competitive and innovative world that we live in today, even a man who's selling a hot dog on the street and on Fifth Avenue in Manhattan over there must do his own research to produce a better hamburger for the customers to buy that product. Therefore, what would you suggest, sir? Should be the research model for a school? How should this research be done? Should students also be involved in that research, or only the teachers over there? Or do we do research as part of an ecosystem with institutes of higher learning, with colleges, with industry, with NGOs, with thought leaders like you? What sort of a model would you recommend?
Well, I think there are many different models depending on your purpose. You know, my recommendation for research, really number one, is ask the right questions. I think in educational research, if you read educational research, people spend a lot of time doing pseudoscience. They're not asking important questions, significant questions. I don't know if you read literature. There are probably thousands of education journals. If you read them, they're not interested. Some of them are really stupid, you know. Some of the best journals publish stupid articles because they have the right methodology. But the key is to ask the right questions. And who can ask the right questions? You know, for example, another thing I can give an example of. I was reading a study in the problem, one of the most influential journals called Educational Researcher. by AERA, you know, American Education Research Association. And they did, they said, we want to study 21st century skills. So they went around all the advertisement, tens of thousands of them. They analyzed that and said, well, not everybody mentioned this, you know, only mentioned this once, twice. This is how stupid that is. Because if they are looking for jobs, they're looking for employees, they're not looking for entrepreneurs. You know, employees in that case may or may not exert, you know, 21st century skills. So the question is fundamentally wrong. You're looking at the wrong data, you're going to different ways. So the most important thing in education research is asking the right question. You know, what questions? How people learn. That's important. How people learn in different contexts. And also education research in context matters. Right, you know, so what context? Education, you know, we call schools were made by human beings. They can be undone by human beings. So therefore you cannot say research in this school apply to another school. So you have to describe the context very well to say how people learn under this context with this support. I think that's the important thing. I just feel like right now, education research needs to change because education research has become a business. Professors have to publish. You have to publish. You know, that's why you have to publish stupid things. I wish we could reward professors for not publishing. If it's bad, it's not published, right? So that's, I hope we education research institution would run to say, ask the right question. What matters? Like today, you know, there's so many people doing research on COVID-19. That's not interesting. What's interesting is to say, with the COVID-19, with remote learning, how do you combine, how do you improve? So if students were involved in that piece, how can they get better? Oh, another one to say, you know, when people say COVID-19 has caused damage to a lot of students, they call learning loss. But why are there about 30% of children who actually enjoy this? That's actually very interesting. You want to say, okay, why are they enjoying this? So you need to study the exceptional things. You know, I can go on because I teach a course on educational research, but this is, you know, I know you don't need this, all of my comments on this.
And also, Professor, another thing connected with research is this whole aspect of purpose of education that you spoke about. So purpose of schooling, I mean, not confusing education with schooling. So we assume that people know about the purpose of education. We think we know, we think all our stakeholders know. It requires a lot of research and discussion by itself, I would say. So having a kind of discussion with all the stakeholders could also give us a lot of topics for research, or questions for research.
Well, I think that the big thing, you know, because I've been doing research, God, since 1980s. So I've been doing this for 30 some years. Research, I've supervised a lot of PhD students in different countries. You know, I think a challenge is that a lot of educational researchers do not have a broad view of education. You know, a big problem is that they only look at schools. So we have a school, if we do research on schooling, that will happen. I hope, you know, we would do more on educational institutions. So we need more models. People, you know, like in, I'm sure Ms. Rao, you know, and General, you know, you want to look at more models, more ways of education, of teaching. You know, we've invented all these models. For example, most of the new innovations had no research, right? I mean, actually, if you even go back to, you know, and most educational innovators did not come from education researchers. Do you know? You know, like, you know, a lot more people said, hey, I want to start a new school, I want to start a new program. They just go. Then they go read the research. They were not informed by research. And so, you know, actually right now, for example, COVID-19 has created a remote learning. But most of the remote learning had nothing to do with educational research. They did not read what happened, you know? So there were, it's a waste. So what do we need? I mean, actually, by the way, I want to say this, educational schools, you know, I have been helping organize a global education deans conference. We got some people from India. So the deans of educational schools around the world we had several meetings before COVID. And one of the issues was to say, how can we be more impactful? How can we influence policies and practices? Well, we've been asking that question for 50 years, probably. Never works. Because the reason is that our researchers are not dealing with what schools need or parents need. A lot of them are playing with themselves. Do you see what I mean? So if you're playing with yourself, you know, that's why a lot of writings, publications, nobody reads them. You know, in you read them probably, three or four times, and most of them are read by other people who are doing research. You know, this is a big issue. I hope your organization can start different kind of research. You know, again, the research is to say, does it work for students? How does it work?
Yes.
You know, another big issue is with that is in education, we've never treated students as serious owners of their learning. So they always work with adults, with the curriculum, with testing. Another big problem is I wrote a book called What Works May Hurt. If you get a chance, you read that book. It is actually some data I've driven by. It's really we measure the wrong things in schools, which is the general has talked about. So anyway, I don't know how many people here are doing educational research in this. This is the time.
We have initiated that, Professor. We have initiated that at the school level because school teachers are not so much into educational research.
Right.
So that's unfortunate, but fortunately in Indus, we have initiated that. And these are all topics and themes and research questions which will have direct impact on student learning. So our endeavor has been to work on those lines.
Yeah. The idea for teachers, I think teachers need to really think about themselves as a co-learner with the students. I remember when I was beginning teaching, I began teaching in 1985, long time ago. You know, it's basically the idea is that you work with students, your teaching is at the organization level, not necessarily at instructional level. We instruct too much. You know, I've seen, you know, in China and other countries, you know, we praise the best teacher is the person who will start the first writing on the blackboard and end when the time clocks. That's performance. That's not teaching. Teaching is communication. Teaching is dialogue. Teaching is working with the students. We need to change that a lot.
Anya?
You have written some very interesting your work on how to make students self-determined learners. I mean, that is very interesting, again, for all of us to read as teachers. And your skills, the volitional skills that you have mentioned, I think even teachers could use that, not just students. Although you meant it for students, they could use those skills. You said problem-solving skills. I would also add problem-finding skills, decision-making skills, goal-setting skills, and planning skills. I think that is something that could be used as a framework with for teachers as well, for their own self-development. I won't use the word professional development, but for the self-development.
Thank you so much for mentioning that. Self-determination is the way to happiness. Self-determination is human rights. You know, is that, so imagine, all our students come to school really happy. After year three or year four, they began to say, you know, I don't like this, you know, so they began to diverge. Why is that? Because they want self-determination. They want to learn something that's meaningful, that's intentional. And so what I think teachers should do the same. Teachers should treat your teaching as a career. You should be happy. You know what makes people happy? Creativity.
Yes.
You know, when you are creating something new, that's genuine happiness. When you are creating something new, when you are making a contribution to other people's lives, when you can feel that, that's happiness. So use your ability, capacity, uniqueness to create value for others. That's how you enjoy. You know, no matter how much wine you drink, you know, how much things you, that doesn't make you happy. Happiness comes from helping others. And so teachers, I really hope this is an invitation for you to become self-determined. It's really about autonomy, relationship, and mastery. That is, you feel you have a choice. You can go do something. then that is feel you can control your own progress. And then you have relationship with your friends, colleagues, students, others. That is the power of self-determination. As when you have self-determination, you don't need to worry about classroom discipline or motivation because everybody wants to do it. I'm sure as teachers, you've noticed when students are interested in something, they go do it. I think a lot of research on motivation is misleading. You don't need to guide them. You don't need to find this different ways to motivate them. Give them autonomy, lead them to build a relationship and help them to feel they're making progress. I'm sorry, I have to leave in about 3 minutes. And this is such a wonderful opportunity. I've always wanted to come to India. There's a lot of invitations. I have not been able to come to India. So maybe someday I'll come to India. India is one of the countries that just fascinates me. It's democracy, it's history. It's just a beautiful, beautiful place. I'm so happy that we have the chance to chat.
Great. It's a great pleasure interacting with you, Vyanas. Read a lot about you, read all your books, and to see you in person and to hear you deliver your message in person over there is very, very impactful.
Pleasure to invite.
Yeah, and our invite for you to come to Bangalore, which is the Silicon Valley of Asia, is there. You let us know and we will officially invite you to come and spend a few days. And this new school of the future, which we are creating, we would like you to sort of, you know, share your thoughts to build up this scaffolding. In fact, this colloquium is there to build up this scaffolding and get different ideas before we make a minimum viable product, which we're going
Thank to you. Use. You are doing very important things. And thank you for doing that. And I'm so happy to be able to join you. And I'm sorry I have to run to another meeting. And you have a great conference, and it's lovely meeting all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank all you. The best. All the best. Tanya.
Thank you so much, Professor Zhao, General Ray, Mrs. Rao. Professor Zhao had to head for a meeting, but and the conversation that he started, if I may park the comment here with you, General Ray and Mrs. Rao, because he was touching on teachers to become or at teachers at organizational level, not instructional level, and become co-learners. And the point of being happy, which General brings out time and again with us. So while how can we make teachers pro-creativity is something that we would like to discuss later in our reflections. So thank you, General Ray and Mrs. Rao. There is one comment, not a question, but a comment from the audience, which really struck was that you all have rightly said about true reformation takes time. But sometimes in the bid of being an outlier, EdTech, education technologies and innovative projects might actually not give the system the time it needs to transform itself. It cannot be incremental, it has to be exponential. Yes. So in that state, how do we go about it?
Yeah, I think there's a slight difference in what Professor Yong Zhao was saying and what our thinking is. Incrementalism was okay. I mean, you could take 4, 5, 10 years to sort of build up your design in whatever vocation you were in. But today, the speed of change and acceleration is so high that whatever you are thinking of designing 5 years later has already happened in the next 6 months. So to deal with the exponential growth of time and the acceleration over there, you heard what Mike Matthews had to say yesterday, that you need an acceleration mind. Learning has to be accelerated. I mean, time is limited and so much learning has got to be done. According to the IBM, their big research which they have done, to keep pace today with knowledge, learning, you need 102 extra days in the year to keep ahead of the curve. So that is the speed which we are moving over there. Technology is moving exponentially. Schools are linear, local, and they are static. If we don't do what I am suggesting you to do, that we take a moonshot, we take a leap over there, schools may become redundant. And artificial intelligence may replace schools, which is the worst thing that can happen. But if we crawl and we take our own time, this is the price or this is the danger that is lurking around the corner. So there is no homeopathic approach. There is no incremental approach. It has to be an exponential approach, a times 10 approach in business models and customer experience or whatever digital transformation that we're thinking about.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Thank you so much, General Ray, Mrs. Rao. Wish you a very good evening.
Thank you.
So I'll be speaking to all the teachers and schools on Monday at 10:30. I will sum up the whole colloquium. In fact, all the three colloquiums, I will sum them up and try and present some sort of a blueprint in front of all our schools as to what is a probable and a possible way ahead. And then we work towards it. So thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
The 2 days of the Indus International Colloquium have been an enriched experience, giving us a lot to reflect and act upon. As Sir said, it has brought forth ideas, perspectives, possibilities, and even challenges to be able to reimagine the future of education. We intend to meet again, my Indus family, as Sir mentioned, on Monday, to share our reflections and implications that we draw from the colloquiums. We will get to hear General Dre with his closing remarks and vision forward as well. I would also like to thank all our panelists and speakers, panelists who are even here with us right now, and also our audience who've been constantly helping us ideate with their questions, with their polls. The poll will again be active now. There's one more poll that we would like you to spend a minute. Please park in your responses. We shall meet you again. You will get the details from the office of the CEO very shortly. Please feel free to leave any additional comments, suggestions, and feedback that you have for us for at itsupport@itari.in. We will also park the email ID on the chat window. Good evening and goodbye. And thank you for joining us on a Saturday evening. Really appreciate it. The poll is live. Before you leave for the day, before you go for your weekend, please just spend a few seconds and please park in your responses. Thank you so much and goodbye.